You were listening to episode 98 of Mitolife Radio. I'm your host, Matt Blackburn, and today I'm interviewing Kris Sweeting of EMR-Tek. He has really great red light therapy, blue blocking, EMF protection products, but he's been studying light therapy for many years. I believe he was in his teens when he started messing around with light therapy devices. That was really impressive to me because I definitely wasn't doing that in my teens. It wasn't until about 2013, 2014 that I really started to dive into light therapy, mostly using the sun, but I definitely didn't know what I was doing. And in the context of not understanding that polyunsaturated fatty acids, omega-3s, are not essential for health, that changed the dynamic with me and sunlight. So now I would have a totally different practice, totally different view of sun exposure. And what is that, you ask? In a nutshell, it would be being cognizant of my polyunsaturated fat intake, not only in the long term, but in the short term, which I never crave nuts or seeds or any PUFA-containing foods at this point, but I would definitely consume some vitamin E in the form of tocopherols before going out into the sun. And specifically, I would focus on gamma and alpha tocopherol before especially prolonged sun exposure. But you'll love this chat with Kris. He talks about how he reversed his vitiligo and actually repigmented his skin. He talks a little bit about sunscreen, hydrogen peroxide. We talk about car windows, cholesterol, UV light quite a bit, what's called dermal pooling, which he goes into, a little bit about the antiviral effects of ultraviolet light, talk about melanin, photosensitizers, and of course, red light therapy. So here we go. Enjoy the show. We're here with Kris Sweeting. Welcome to the show.
Hey, Matt. How are you doing? Thanks for having me on.
Appreciate it. Thanks for coming on. I always love talking about red light therapy, and it's been really cool watching you on social media with your posts because it seems like you really dive into the science, and it's nice to see you going into other frequencies like ultraviolet, like I've been dabbling in for years, but I started with the sun, and then I was a little cautious moving into devices, reptile bulbs and stuff like that.
But, that's a good call. Just to quickly start off the story, one time I was working at the IGA when I was like 13. It was a food store, and I was just kind of trying to push the limits with the device that I had kind of been grown up using. And it was a four-door UV narrowband UVB tanning bed, and some guy at the grocery store was like, "Man, you really burnt yourself bad." And I was like, "What?" And so I went like looked at my face, and it was just like so red, dude. Like I can't explain. Like I had like a permanent burn for like 4 years. Like it was bad. And yeah, so that, I mean, yeah, you definitely got to be careful. I'm glad that I wore my goggles and didn't open my eyes or anything like that. Holy smokers.
Was it UVA, UVB? Like what?
Yeah, so it was narrow band UVB. So it's 311 to 312 nanometers. But basically that causes dermal pooling, which is, you know, the blood going into the skin. So, you know, it doesn't oxidize the melanin. It doesn't, you know, it gives a really weird burn when you just isolate wavelengths like that. It was the weirdest burn. Like it didn't hurt. It didn't peel, but you could tell I just got zapped. I was like, whoa.
Was that your introduction to light therapy, or how did you kind of get involved in it? Were you trying to treat a condition that you had, or?
Yeah. So I got vitiligo, which is the same disease that Michael Jackson had. It's an autoimmune condition, basically where your melanocytes die. So those are the little things that produce melanin, which is the pigment. that colors your skin and also protects you from sunlight. But maybe, well, let's talk about that later. So I got that when I was like 3. And then by the time I was 9, after trying, you know, tons of different therapies, one was like a tar cream, which was terrible, and UVA actually. My mom found this this German doctor basically, and we went to see her, and we were actually with a group of patients. Most of them were older than me, and yeah, it ended up working for me. It works for basically everyone, and it works even better if you're in the Dead Sea, which is kind of an interesting thing. It's because of all the different haze of the minerals in the sky and the water, and you know, it's but yeah, I ended up repigmenting my skin, so that's why I had these lights in my room growing
wow.
up. Yeah, I had them since I was about 5. We started off with the UVA. Yeah,
that's really cool, because I've seen people over the years, like when I was teaching at a juvenile detention facility, I would see young kids, young women mostly, but some boys that had extreme discoloration, like vitiligo.
Mm-hmm.
And I think they were told that it was incurable, right? I mean, that's usually what they say.
Yeah, I mean, they told me literally, they told my mom. I didn't know. I was too young to really like hear this stuff, but they were, apparently she said, yeah, they said, carry an umbrella and stay out of the sun, you know, wear sunscreen, which is funny because, you know, it's going to cause more free radicals. And some of those are going to be H2O2, which, you know, hydrogen peroxide, we have too high levels in our skin, and that H2O2 molecule actually destroys the melanocytes. So yeah.
Wow. So with sunscreen, I mean, am I understanding it right that it blocks UVB and allows UVA, or is that flipped?
Yeah, so most sunscreen will block UVA and UVB. Hmm. They're broad spectrum. Some block probably, you know, only UVB, but I mean, that's probably even worse. I mean, just blocking the UVB. The thing is, Matt, so the UVB triggers the melanin produced from the melanocytes, and then it shifts it to the apex of the nucleus, and literally forms a shield that absorbs, they kind of like the light reflects off it, and also it absorbs free radicals like a little scavenger. So if you have no UVB and you're just like letting the UVA beat on you, then you know, I think that's pretty dangerous actually.
That's kind of like when you get a sunburn on a long drive, right? Like, cause a lot of car windows will allow in UVA, but block UVB.
Yeah, that's messed up. And it will lead to not only skin cancer, but like, and like the bad kind, melanoma, but it definitely going to photoage your skin too, because it literally shields the DNA. That melanin barrier literally shields the DNA. So you're just acquiring, you know, mutations. So it's not good.
Wow. Yeah. Cause I've heard about, I think it was Dr. Sebi, or there were some characters that talked about how African Americans, they have a better relationship with the sun. I think because of the melanin, right? They have more melanin, so they need more sun to mm-hmm. get the same effect or something like that.
Well, I think there's different opinions, you know, in terms of vitamin D, at least. I think one of the opinion is, vitamin D is not like based on like the color of your skin and the amount of sun. It's like the amount of cholesterol that's in your skin. So yeah, I think there's varying research on that. I'm not sure it's fully decided.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. So backing up here, so you repigmented your skin, mm-hmm. and then what? You just started experimenting with tons of lights, or?
Yeah. So I was like 14, 14 and a half. And then I was like, I was like this really, like it didn't seem that weird now, but now it seems really weird. I would like come home and like play some Warcraft or something. But then like after, I'd spend like 2.5 hours like researching what herbs could like enhance my testosterone, right? Because I was on this like working out kick, and I had really always been, I was like, damn, this is the key, right? So I started looking it up, and then I was like, oh shit. And then I came across like some literature that said like light could increase it, and sunlight, and so then I was like, oh damn. So I started like experimenting with my light. By the time I was like 19, I was I was actually putting on like transdermal pregnenolone and trying to like direct the hormonal conversions with light. I know it's retarded, but that word's fine here.
No, I think that has efficacy. I know Danny Roddy does that, and a lot of people use transdermal. I think there are some safer hormones like at the top of the rung, like pregnenolone and progesterone, that are fairly safe. DHEA is a little less safe.
I think one of my buddies took seven keto DHEA for like water weight or something like that. I don't know. He was obsessed with that shit.
Well, that's funny, because I kind of had a similar journey where I was addicted to, it was World of Warcraft. I was into RPGs ever since I was like 10, because I was raised on computers and just really my imagination. But I started with conspiracies for like 5 years, trying to figure out what's going on in the world, which you'll just go nuts. I have friends that's their business, but it's dangerous, because you just get so pissed off and confused, and there's always new rabbit holes. And so I got into health. I guess it's a similar thing with health. There's constant rabbit holes. You know, nitric oxide's good. No, it's bad. You know, it's all these things. But,
for sure.
So you started messing around with light, and you were using all different frequencies. You were using UV, red light.
So I was using, at that time, it was UVA. I had a UVA tanning booth, and then I had a UVB, one with UVB bulbs. So I had like a just basically a single panel, like where you had to turn around. And then I had like a four-door narrowband UVB. I feel like I was at that time, like I've had a lot of surgeries, and I had a really bad motorcycle accident. So I've had a bunch of different surgeries and nerve transpositions and so on. But I used to be really big. And I think that part of the reason that I attained like all that mass without steroids was because I was using that therapy, because I mean, my genetics are like fairly good, but they're not like, I was way bigger than these guys running like stacks of juice. So I was like, that's not right. And they had, you know, so it was weird.
Supposedly that's how the Russians were doing so well in like the Olympics, right? Have you heard that story? They're doping with light.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I'm not surprised. You know, it's like Anderson Silva, you know, that guy who like kicked Chris Weidman's leg and then snapped it right in half. I mean, you know, the vitamin, the narrowband UVB will harden your bones, right? So I think it's important for a lot of different athletes to, you know, I think it's performance enhancing. I think it probably is more performance enhancing than red light, truthfully. Especially if it's mixed with UVA and UVB, like a mixture, I think that's like, that's where it's at, in my opinion. It just feels so good too, right?
Yeah, that's interesting. And so the reason that it's more performance enhancing, is it because of like sulfating cholesterol? And I know there's like beta endorphin. And there's a bunch of compounds, like people tend to focus in on the secosteroid hormone D, but that's like a side note, right? That's almost like icing on the cake. That's kind of separate to most of the UV benefits.
So I think that obviously like bone strength is super important for athletic performance. The beta endorphin release is significant to the point where I'm like addicted to this light now. And no, it's really, I don't, you know, come on, Matt, it's an addiction. But it's really bad. I literally like have issues going a day without running some light through this system, because it makes my mood feel so bad. I kind of like, I'm starting to wonder like how, if I keep doing it, will I be like addicted to light? Like, it's really weird, but yeah.
Is there a timing? Cause I got into this a lot later than you. Like, I think I was, when I really got obsessed with light and I was reading Lieberman and all these books, Let There Be Light and all these things. I was like, I don't know, that was maybe 4 or 5 years ago. And I was living in an RV and I changed out all the RV lights for red LEDs, which I think kind of stressed me out because they probably weren't the right type of LED. But I was running like UV over my bed at night. So I had like UV and red. And there's this whole circadian timing aspect, right, to light. And
yeah,
like I've heard that ultraviolet doesn't, like, there's no detriment to using it any time of day. And that seems so counterintuitive to people. Are you aware of that? Or
yeah,
is it?
So the doctor, she was actually a PhD researcher and a medical doctor in Germany. And she told me to use it at in the afternoon, the narrow band. I think it's just, I think there is an aspect like to the circadian biology there that, like, you know, you don't want to shock it with too much UV right in the morning. I'm sure there's, you know, truth to what, you know, people say about that. You know, certain wavelengths, you know, need to be in a certain order almost, you know. It's like, you know, red in the morning, UV in the afternoon. I mean, that's what I do. That's what I was instructed, and I feel like that's the way to approach it.
Okay. Yeah, I just started wearing my Aura ring again because I don't like wearing things most of the time, but it's one of the best things I've used to kind of track my sleep. And it's been really interesting for me because I'm always experimenting with stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And so I, you know, that uses infrared light 250 times a second to take readings of heart rate variability, body temperature drops, you know, deep sleep, REM sleep when you're awake.
That's great.
It'd be interesting for me. I want to use my UV light like 5 minutes before bed and then track and see if that affects my sleep, if it improves it or brings it down.
Yeah, I think generally I sleep better when I do the light. You know, you can do too much and then you get really hot, right? Because of the dermal pooling. It's like you pool too much of that blood in your skin. It feels like you're like, you know, super, super hot and then you can't sleep. But, you know, I've been thinking about the dermal pooling a lot. And, you know, I read that mouse study where the narrow band UVB reduced arterial, like vascular inflammation. And then I was like, and thereby prevented arteriosclerosis. And then, you know, obviously, you know, vitamin D levels are hugely correlated with, you know, heart disease and stuff. And I know that this is actually, it's something that runs in my family as well. And then I just recently, a recent study, a huge cohort of basically narrow band patients for vitiligo used it, and they found a significant difference in cardiovascular and cerebral vascular outcomes. So I think it's actually looking pretty much like this stuff is reducing, the UV light is reducing cardiovascular events. And I think it does that because it pulls blood into the skin and then it creates slack in all the other arteries, right? Like the major arteries, you know, if you're literally like creating slack in the vessels, and because some of the blood's going into your skin.
That's really interesting. The way I started studying light is that light is more effective than any herb on the planet because we're acting on a more fundamental level.
Yeah.
And I know with like red light therapy, it's kind of like different tools, right? So if you're going to use UV, that's one tool. If you're going to use red light, that's a different tool with a different purpose. Mm-hmm. And I know with red light, like CCO, like cytochrome C oxidase is focused on, but there's also this like exclusion zone water and like making the water in the mitochondria less viscous, right? Red light.
Yeah. So I don't know too much about exclusion zone water and all that water stuff. I mean, what I do know is my Italian partner did some kind of like biometric data assessment on, or maybe it's not biometric. That's probably the wrong word to use. But it's some like analysis on like the fat mass of a couple clients he was shining it on. And the client was more hydrated and skinnier, like less fat mass after 3 days. And so, you know, he seemed to think that was related to the easy water or something like that. But I mean, I don't actually know enough about that to comment, but it's interesting.
Yeah. I still have Gerald Pollack's book, University of Washington, like the fourth phase of water. And people say it's easy to read. It's pretty heady. And it's an easy.
Like I have to listen to audiobooks. Like I can't do the reading thing. Like flipping the pages is like really just not for me.
Yeah. And I think people learn differently for sure. I think I'm the same way. I prefer to like watch a lecture or to listen to someone.
Yeah. Oh, totally. And you like, you, it's like totally for me, that's how it works. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Have you heard that red light can stimulate the lymphatic system, or is that UV and red? Because I think people have this conception that you have to do aerobic exercise to move your lymphatic system, but light alone could do it from what I've seen.
I actually don't know about that either. You're probably right. I mean, this stuff is crazy. It's doing a lot of things. What's actually happening, you know, is interesting to me, because people report a lot of different things, but it's like, you know, what's the fundamental, like, what are these things? What are these devices actually useful for? It's like, you know, in a real practical sense, it's like, yeah, I don't know, Matt, how you probably do know how it moves around the system. So let me just ask you, I'm here to learn. Anyway.
Yeah. Gerald Pollack used, I think, Nathion tubes, and it was like a hydrophilic, substance. And so that hydrophilic means water loving, hydrophobic is water repelling. And I guess a lot of the surfaces in our mitochondria are hydrophilic. And so it kind of brings water to it. And in so doing, I think that's the mechanism but I think it's doing everything. I mean, it's more fundamental than food, right?
Yeah. I mean, and it's crazy to think that we can like alter something so fundamental. And like, I mean, you know, that's where I agree, you know, with a lot of stuff that Jack says. It's like, you know, that it's really crazy to see the fundamental X factor being so like, we're just really not smart humans. Like, man, holy shit. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I've been to people's houses, and I'm sure this is most people in America, where they have, you know, really harsh white LEDs above their kitchen table. So they're getting blasted during every dinner.
Yep.
Maybe they have them on during the day. There's under artificial, I mean, especially with this, you know, COVID, yes, it's like everyone's living more of an indoor existence now, mm-hmm. doing everything wrong dietarily, drinking tap or whatever, you know, or bottle of plastic water.
That stuff is crazy. And, you know, the tap water, people like, people say I have like, you know, nice skin, and like, I'm into cosmetics and stuff. I have my own cosmetics company. But one thing that I never do is I put like hard water on my face. Like, and like that freaks, like, they're like, oh, you don't wash my face. I'm like, I wash my beard, but like, I don't really wash my face. I'm not, you know, I don't put like hard water on my face. Like, I just think that the water is so terrible these days, you know, it's just.
Oh yeah. Yeah. And we absorb it through our skin. Like,
yeah,
I think one of the best things people could do, like, I've been using the Relax Sauna again, it's like this little affordable tent setup, but mm-hmm. just giving yourself a water change, like sweating it out with the dry sauna, putting yep. in good water, maybe yep. adding in some UV or red light therapy. It's like, that's going to do more for you than a lot of supplements would.
I think you're talking about just like removing all the crap, but you know, but instead of putting more crap, because you know, most supplements and stuff are probably not even that good, you know, for you. I mean, like, you, so it's crazy. I know you have a huge problem with some supplements out there. shit. Yeah. Yeah, you know, that's a really interesting thing, right? So I remember I was watching your post, and it was like, you're like, you know, cells emit ultra low frequency UV light, and you know, the short chain carbon fats are like, you know, PUFAs, right? That's what you're talking about, and they get oxidized super easily by UV light, you know, as well as like other, you know, EMF as well. But it's like, you know, that made sense to me. I was like, shit.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. More than two double bonds, the polyunsaturated fats, and it just makes sense. I mean, you look at studies with lipid peroxidation, and you mm-hmm. look at what is putting lipid peroxidation, the oxidation of these fats, on steroids, and it's like iron overload, which is everywhere, endotoxin, which everyone has at this point. It's just all these things. It's like everyone's just rusting from the inside out, and I think.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. A pharmacist told me that she found that people with familial hypercholesterolemia that have like pretty bad outcomes, and she thought that generally it was a result of iron dysregulation. And so I think you maybe agree with that, or, you know, sounds like you do.
Yeah. Yeah. A lot of the lipofuscin accumulates in the reticuloendothelial system, which is just the iron recycling system. And these PUFAs will form this plastic material with the iron. And I think that's why I'm so into red light therapy. And that's why I push it so hard to my audience, because I'm like, it's like, I've had Morley Robbins on the show. He's awesome many times. And he said that red light therapy resonates with the frequency of copper, which regulates the iron. And artificial blue light resonates with the frequency of iron, which makes sense because everything's blue backlit, you know, to poison
us. Yeah, you know, there's strange ties to these kind of things in nature that you find, and that's interesting.
Yeah. Sure. Yeah. So I wanted to ask you about antiviral, because that's one of the most exciting aspects to UV light. And I think that's one of the books I have. I think it's called Into the Light. Pretty sure it's the name of the book. And he goes pretty deep into intravenous UV light therapy.
So you mean like UV blood irradiation?
Yeah, and we don't even have to go IV, but just through the skin with, say, UV light. Like, I've seen studies.
Yeah, well, I mean, not well. Actually, no. In the mouse study, it was reducing some. It was like modulating something inside the artery. So I guess it does reach there. I mean, I don't really know.
Yeah, with this whole, you know, quote unquote pandemic, people have been like, "What do I do?" And I'm like, I think we have all the solutions. Like, if I had this thing, you know, I would use methylene blue, UV light, and truly wild Mediterranean oregano. But if you just add methylene blue and UV light, I think that would do it, because there were studies showing that killed COVID.
The COVID. Terrible. So I think UVA is best at killing it. Obviously, UVC, I think it's 254 nanometer UVC light is best at destroying viral DNA. And it has to be at a radiance of 2.5 milliwatts. Actually, there's something I want to talk about in the future with you. We'll have a little chat about that whole thing, because I got a new idea. I think it's interesting. I think definitely, you know, the UVB activates T cells. And the vitamin D, it increased vitamin D status. So I think that, you know, I'm not sure you can just, I mean, I don't know about, like, you know, it's probably going to help, you know, if you can't get sunlight, but it's like, it's not going to like disinfect you from the inside, you know, like, but, you know, obviously.
Have you messed with like photosensitizers, like, methylene blue?
No, I haven't messed with that. But I used to do like PUVA, which is like, you put like photosensitizer. Not too many photosensitizers, you know. I have to be very careful with my skin, right? Like, I don't want that stuff coming back. So I'm really like crazy about what I put on my skin. Which is why I only put the stuff that I'm making in South Korea, which is like the Hubbo Cosmetics. It's the shit.
That's cool. Well, this is going to be an explicit episode, like my last one with Kitty. So it's two in a row. I like it. Yeah. Do you want to jump into the Q&A, Kris? Because we have a lot of questions, and we can just bang them out. They're pretty good ones. So can just go through them real quick here. Let's see. This is a good one to start. What's the easiest argument against those big brains who don't approve of unnatural frequencies? Pretty much using man-made light versus the sun.
Yeah, that's funny. So go try and regrow your hair in the sunlight and let me know how that works.
Nice, simple enough.
I mean, there's a reason why they're using laser combs. I can actually tell you, like, I know all five mechanisms of how red light regrows hair. So basically it stimulates epidermal stem cells, shifts the hair follicle from dormant phase to growth phase, telogen to anagen phase. It increases ATP, increases circulation, and it actually reduces scalp DHT. So DHT is, it's like a androgen, and it basically binds the hair follicle, depletes of oxygen, and basically kills or miniaturizes the, at least that's what the you know, common consensus of the medical medium is. You know, it's never, unfortunately, not always true, but.
No, that makes sense. I know there's this whole huge hormonal aspect to hair. And I think, you know, we can look at our parents, especially as a man, look at our dad and kind of see what could happen to us and then try to, like, you know, prepare for that. And usually what I see is, like, men have the bald spot on the top of their head, right? And they still have the hair on the side and the back.
Yeah, that's, you know, that was happening to me. And I was like, obviously it's not a thrilling thing to have happen to you. It's like, you know, it's like you're going to deal with it, but it's not my first choice. And so I used this shampoo and I used the little light, the Firewave, and I put it at my head at about 8 inches. And then I used this the shampoo called Regenipure DR. I have no affiliation with this company, but man, that shit works. So. It's got like ketoconazole in it. It actually reduces scalp DHT. So does the light. But yeah, I mean, that's why people take finasteride. It's like it's one of those drugs that suppresses like androgens, DHT, but it has a range of, you know, terrible effects. And so, it reduces scalp THC, and then there's some like peppermint in it and stuff. It's like natural vasodilators. So it works really well. And, you know, there's a couple ingredients that are a little harsh that I might change, you know, if I make one. But for now, I mean, I literally grew all my hair back, like not all of it, but it was pretty bad. You know, it was pretty bad. I was like, this is not a good situation.
Yeah, I'm glad you brought up hard water earlier, because I think whether it's the skin or the hair, just getting the basic shower filter, I mean, it's, you know, it's still not optimal, but it's way better than tap, just to have some type of a barrier between your municipal source or even your well source and your hair.
Yeah, man, there's a lot of issues with hard water and hair. It's inflammatory, the water, and so yeah, I try not to. Are we on video right now? Because I feel like it's gonna, I have no lights on in my head.
Like, no, this only has audio, so good. Yeah. We're good. This is a good practical one. So how long is too long per session? I tend to average like an hour or two a day, but I'm getting no light here just because we're heading into winter. And then can you get too much red light? So those kind of go hand in hand. So like,
Mm-hmm. So there's definitely like biphasic dose response. You know, there's like a sweet spot. It's a bell curve. If you go over, the positive effects get negated. Mm-hmm. Definitely if you go over with like UV light, you're going to have a really bad night. And I hope no one, everyone who listens to this never, you know, just always double check the timer and like, you know, but yeah, sorry, I got it distracted there. I wanted to.
Yeah. So what's that?
What's like an optimal time? Like I can tell you what I do, you know, with my red light therapy.
I've heard like 20 minutes a session, but you can break it up into like two or three rounds, right? It's more like at one time that matters.
Yeah. Essentially, Some people find that it can disrupt their sleep if they use it too late in the day. So I generally say like use it in the morning. That's what I find that helps my customers the most, and they seem to like that. And then also I think it's really important I think the best way to do light therapy is like in your bed, you know, like if you can hang it over and just like, you know, turn it on and just chill there and do some deep breathing or something. I'm sure that there's some sort of synergy going on, you know, because of the way that red light works on the mitochondrial respiratory chain. It's like if you're increasing oxygen tensions, because what happens with red light is you're releasing the nitric oxide, the oxygen is more effectively processed. So if you have more oxygen tensions, then, you know, maybe more ATP can be formulated. So I try and do some deep breathing, and I'm totally like a yogi now.
Maybe I wonder if you could hang it from the ceiling horizontal and then kind of raise it and lower it, like raise it over the bed when you're not using it and then lower it.
Yeah,
that'd be a cool product. Yeah. But I guess you rig that up.
Yeah, I've actually had Sarah Hodgkins had something like with my light, and she was like doing that kind of thing. That's yeah. Cool. Yeah.
Nice. Let's see. Does red light therapy contribute to healing leaky gut in any way?
Yeah. So my friend Sean Bean, you know Sean Bean, he wrote a couple blogs on that. I actually can't remember exactly what they said. In one study, it showed that, okay, so yeah, so this is what it was. In one mouse study, it altered the kind of good bacteria in the gut. So it increased it by 10,000 times the good bacteria, which is like, I don't even know how that happens. You know, it's like 10,000 times. Holy smoke. Obviously, you know, does that translate into humans? What I know is that Sean Bean seems to think that it's definitely possible that it's going to help leaky gut. Specifically, and we have a couple blogs on that. So if you want to check those out, then feel free.
Cool. What about the eyes? Someone asked benefits of light therapy to the eyes. My vision is super clear after each session and have improved in general. It's my understanding near infrared is one of the most beneficial. Is that right? Or
I think, yeah, I think obviously there's the most mitochondria in the eye. There's that new pilot study that came out that said it can improve vision by like 20% in people over 40. And that was like 670 nanometer light. They were using 25 milliwatts was the dose. I think that maybe I'm not exactly sure if it's near infrared that is the best for it. That could potentially be true, but it would only be true at doses that are not detrimental, because I think potentially there is some caution that needs to be exercised with the near infrared light on the old eyeball.
Yeah, I'm helping my neighbor because it's fun being here in Idaho, like moving into a neighborhood and be like, I'm a health guy, you know, let me help you guys out. And so I've been like helping my neighbors out and stuff. And awesome. I have a bunch of red light therapy devices here that sometimes give away or let people borrow. And he's been using that little near infrared on his eyes just 10 minutes twice a day. And he said it's improving. He had like the lens was separating, I guess was his issue. Mm-hmm. So he'd had really foggy vision. And he said the light, and I have him on vitamin E, you know, my vitamin E, which helps the eyes and stuff. But kind of a cool anecdote.
I've actually had a lot of different people tell me that their eyes have improved, and they always send me the tests, like their last test, they took a photo and this is their new test. And, you know, one guy was doing like eyeball exercises with it. And so, I mean, I think it's always better to tackle the problem, you know, from multiple angles. So maybe the eyeball exercises, red light therapy, the vitamin E. Report back in 6 months.
Yeah, limit the poofas. So about safety with eyes, people asked, can I keep my eyes open when using the firewall? I think they mean fire wave or goggles. Do I have to wear protective eyewear? It's only with UV, right? You have to be careful.
Well, I mean, there's so definitely with UV. I mean, I had a doctor call, and she was like, because I think one of my lamps maybe didn't come with like instructions or something like that. It just happens once in a while. And she thought it was like, she was like, oh my God, because this guy was using one of the UV, I shouldn't say the name of the brand, but it was a UV, device. And apparently he like didn't wear any eye protection and he really burnt his eyeballs. Yeah, really bad apparently.
Oh no.
Yeah.
Do you know if like, because I have like a stand up vertical tanning UV custom built light that I stand in front of and like turn like a rotisserie. If I stand in front of that with my eyes shut, you still need goggles, right? Because I heard something about like even if like it'll go through your eyelids and it makes it worse or something. Dude, I don't know.
Honestly, I used to tan in that narrow band thing with no goggles on. And I did it for like 2 years. But don't take my advice. It's probably not good advice. But I'm just telling you what I did. My eyes are definitely not perfect. They're like -1.5 or something like that. But, you know, I wasn't blind. I did it like, but I really closed my eyes because you can definitely see some of the light getting through. But if you really squint them, anyways, things not to do.
Well, I saw a study. I can't remember. I believe it was actually UVA showing that they were using UVA light therapy treat macular degeneration. I don't know if you've seen, have you seen beneficial studies of UV on the eyes? Cause I have.
I like isolated UV. I've never even looked at that. Cause the medical medium has owned me, you know, I didn't even think to check. Isn't that crazy? Relaxing on that stuff.
You're in your celery juice bath with your red light.
If there's a threshold of only, you know, you're fine until you drink this much celery juice, then you're not, and you can never get it back.
You lost your mind for life. Yeah. So we have people asking. Yeah, we have people asking about the skin, like, and I just kind of lumped all these skin questions together. So we have acne scars, eczema, and you've touched a little bit of this, but facial eczema, will it tighten the skin? Megadosing seems to work best. Someone said 10 times a day recommended. So kind of like, I guess your general ideas on red light therapy and various skin issues, like is the treatment time and the protocol pretty much the same no matter what skin thing you're working on?
No, I think skin really needs a lot less light in terms of red light therapy because literally I've seen in one study, it's like skin rejuvenation was reported at like 0.5 milliwatts, which is almost nothing. It's like you could be it's almost nothing. It's that would do it. That'd definitely do it. So, you know, obviously anything inflammatory will likely benefit from the red and near infrared light application. I think that, you know, if you're going to do like, I think that the facial skin in general is really sensitive. I think that you can have kind of synergistic effects if you apply topical antioxidant serums potentially before. This is obviously, you know, I'm just, I've done it a little bit. You know, I've been making some skincare, basically working with a South Korean lab for about 2 years now, and I've been working on this stuff, and I've been putting it on my face. And at first, I was terrified, right? Because it's always scary putting something on your face that you don't know what it is, really, right? And I mean, it's like, it could have caused vitiligo or whatever, but it's really, really helped my skin in terms of just, it's like vibrancy. And I think that could help some people in combination with the red light, and obviously just make sure that they're preferably like all really green grade ingredients. So yeah.
Cool. Is that like early next year where you're going to launch your skincare or?
Yeah, I think I'm going to do it as soon as possible. I mean, I've had some recent delays. Actually, it's interesting because I had like a hacker access my manufacturing facility their email, and they tried to get me to transfer money to Thailand. Yeah, and so it was kind of sketchy. So it made me like chill out for a second and just reevaluate. I was like, can I pay my credit card?
This year has been just wild for everyone for every reason.
Yeah, Yeah, it's really, it really is crazy.
Everyone needs more red light.
I looked at a market analysis for red light or for light therapy and the light impact of COVID-19, and it's like, or COVID, and it said that red light therapy was going to see the biggest boost. So we'll see about that. But
that's really cool,
and it's good to see, you know.
Yeah, I think it just has so many applications, and especially if you're on an animal-based diet, you know, minimizing PUFAs, not restricting macronutrients, eating saturated fat and carbs and stuff.
Yeah. So I actually wanted to ask you a couple questions about this stuff too. What are you eating these days? Like, I've been really interested in, like, we talked a little bit before this interview, and I'm like, I'm digging the lifestyle out in the woods. You know, I'm gonna get a crossbow and like catch my own deer and stuff. You know, it's like, sounds like a really fun, and you know, I'm bored as heck in the city here. And also, I feel like the game meat would be so much more, like, you know, nutritious and clean. And it's like, I'm, you know, so.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm looking forward to eating more moose and elk. I haven't had moose yet. I've had elk a few times, but.
Okay. Are you hunting it, or are you picking it up? Or, I mean,
I'm working on getting the hunting and skinning thing down. Today was actually my first little training. So right. I'm taking it slow and learning the cuts and all that. But yeah, basically eating like eggs, you know, milk from unlimited raw goat milk from my doe that I have, eggs from my chickens.
He's unlimited? How is he? must produce a lot of milk.
Yeah, she was producing like a half gallon a day for a while. Holy, and now it's just that was one milking a day. And then it's moved down to about, you know, half of that now. But
okay.
It's still enough for me. Like, it's enough for me to make goat cheese if I want, which is awesome.
And that's great.
Yeah, so I'm doing a lot of eggs, milk, you know, red meat, a lot of bone broth, like 50 ounces of bone broth a day. Just kind of focusing on, you know, I add a lot of sugar to my goat's milk, and
you really focus on the amino acids and eating cleanly.
I was protein deficient for a good 8 years, probably, when I was vegetarian, vegan, or longer. So I think my growth was a little stunted because I was amino deficient. And so I feel really good on a steak a day, as long as I balance that phosphorus with calcium and balance the cysteine and methionine with proline and glycine and the broth and collagen. Really big into gummies and gelatin and stuff. So
I just went dark there, man. So I decided to turn on a light. I usually don't. I'm usually in bed at like 7:30. Yeah, it's a similar diet for me. I think it's also, you probably have done your research on like carbohydrates in terms of, I mean, so, okay, no, this is something that I'm curious, no, because I know you do your research and it's so, and honestly, lately, I haven't been able to dive into it. And I wanted to ask your, what your thoughts on this was. Like, it's like, about the sugar issue with the heart disease, because quite frankly, I have FH, right? Like, I have that gene. So my lipid levels are off the chart. I mean, my total cholesterol is around 9. And my grandfather actually passed away from it when he was 33, and he had his first heart attack at 27. And so, you know, it's been other in my family as well. So I'm interested in hearing your opinion on this, because, you know, obviously I have to weigh all the information on this. And it's, you know, I'm interested in hearing your opinion because, well, I know you do your research, so.
Yeah. So it's my understanding that if the free fatty acids in the serum are derived from polyunsaturated fats, like stored in your tissues or ingested, but usually it's a stress response. And so let's say you eat a steak with no carbs, a lot of protein, a huge bolus of protein creates a huge insulin response. And if there's not the sugar to back that up,
right,
then your body's like, where's the sugar? I have all this insulin and I need sugar. And okay. So it's going to raise cortisol and adrenaline.
Right. And cortisol will block your arteries, because that's one thing that Russ Scala said, which was, he's like, you know, he said that low testosterone and high cortisol, which is obviously like this inverse relationship, is what blocks the arteries of all these marathon runners. Yeah.
That's interesting. Yeah. That's
20 years of research for him, but figuring that out. Yeah.
Wow. That's fascinating. Yeah. And I just released a niacinamide supplement, which is to me the safest form of B3 and one of the most affordable. And
Go ahead.
Well, and that, I was just gonna say, that reduces free fatty acids, circulating free fatty acids, as does vitamin E, as does aspirin, but you don't have to go there if you don't want to. But just vitamin E and niacinamide are very effective against, you know, diabetes-like conditions.
Right. Yeah. Okay. So there was something that my doc was telling me about, because it was like niacin. Was it niacin? What is niacinamide compared to niacin? Because I know there's, in certain situations, doctors will put patients on niacin because it like reduces some sort of lipid distribution particle, like small particle or something like that. Is that?
Yeah. I've seen some studies where it has like a beneficial balance on the, on a cholesterol, but I think it's dangerous. I think the beneficial studies on niacin, it really depends on the context of the animal, the condition of the animal, and the PUFA content of their fat tissue.
Yeah.
So like with niacin, it's my understanding it causes lipolysis. And so you're forcing your fat cells to open up, and you'll have a dumping of serotonin, histamine, and inflammatory prostaglandins. Whereas with niacinamide, you don't have any flushing effect, which is safe. It's also called nicotinic acid in the research. So if you just search, those are used synonymously. That's what makes it really confusing, because you'll search niacin in the studies, and there's nicotinic acid. They rarely say niacinamide, usually nicotinic acid.
Okay. And, interesting.
And then you have nicotinamide riboside, NAD, which I've played with for anti-aging, but niacinamide boosts NAD just as much, and it's way cheaper. And I think it's effective. I mean, it's interesting too, with niacinamide and vitamin E, there's like this synergy with red light I'm still figuring out, and light therapy in general, because both of those help the metabolism, which light helps, right?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I gotta run some lipid panels, some like advanced lipid panels, and see what's going on with me, and then approach it. So that's what I'm trying to figure it out. But yeah, man, interesting.
Yeah, it's fun to continue studying all this stuff. Pregnancy, I think pregnant women wonder if it's safe or how to use it. Right on the belly, right, would be awesome.
Well, I mean, I don't. I mean, in one study in like the male mice, I think they were using it helped the infant mice reach maturity quicker. So I don't know if that's necessarily a good thing or a bad thing, but that's really all I've read on pregnancy. So that's all I can really give. I'm a little cautious though, in terms of, you know, I don't know about the pregnancies. Who knows?
Well, if a woman has a fetus in there, like the visible red light penetrates superficial, right? It's not very deep.
Well, it's not gonna reach.
The infrared goes four to 6 inches.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, I think it's probably dependent on, you know, again, the tissue and certain variants, but I'm unsure about the whole baby irradiation issue.
Maybe just limited, like limited dose or something.
That's what I say for like little kids, you know. It's like, you know, if they're like 30 pounds and you're like 200 pounds and you're doing like 20 minutes, give them like, you know, a fifth of it, you know, give them like a couple minutes.
Let me see here. Thoughts on using it on the thyroid that's been diagnosed with cancer. Definitely consult their doc, right? But after that.
definitely. I mean, I think you know probably this, Matt, like there's varying like thoughts on cancer, right? It's like some people think that it turbocharges the cell, and then it's like, you know, on cancers, like just feeding it energy. In my opinion, it's like, I feel like, and then there's other studies that like show it can be helpful, you know, for people who are undergoing like chemotherapy and stuff like that. I think, you know, yeah, obviously I'm not even sure. It'd be inappropriate for me to comment at all on that because I just don't know.
Yeah, that's good. I mean, I guess I look at it as red light therapy is just improving the function of your cells overall and reducing stress. And if you do that in the context of a foundation, like we talked about before, good water, you're bathing in good water, you're eating animal products, maybe supplementing the right things, not supplementing the wrong things, then I feel like red light is just a perfect thing to help balance.
You know, I'll be honest, the way I use my lamp is on my head. Obviously, you know, back in the day when I was having those hair issues, my girlfriend at the time was giving me a head rub and she was like, oh my God, I can feel all these hairs and like these little hairs like come in. And I'm like, and so I felt them and I'm like, oh yeah, that's, you know, that's all the telogen ones shifting. I also feel like, you know, 50% of mood issues are related to systemic or neuroinflammation. There's been a couple times where I sent my little lamp to, you know, clients because I ran out of stock and someone wanted one really badly. And there was actually one time where this guy was having bugs come out of his body. So that was crazy. And they were like flies and stuff. Yeah, like flies just coming out of his skin, like hatching. And he was like, he's trying to like irradiate them to death. I was like, bro, I don't know. But anyway.
Sounds like an agent from the Matrix got to him or something.
Yeah. Dude, I was like, this can't be a real. I just like before bed, I just put it on my head and, there's a couple studies that show it also induces a hypnotic effect. And so I fell asleep with it. And I know that that's true now because I fell asleep with it on. And I used to use it at the head of my bed and it fell down and burnt a hole in my bed. Because that lens gets hot, right? And so now I use it on like a yoga mat or something where it's very stable. So
that's smart. Yeah, I'm glad you talked about neuroinflammation, and because someone asked about if red light can help mood and alleviate seasonal challenges. And my first introduction to light therapy was with the heat lamps, like the four I mounted to a board. Yeah. A lot of people do like the 250 watt chicken lights. Yep. And I made a little tent with PVC, and I was so addicted, and I felt a definite emotional shift for the positive. Like I felt like I was becoming more resilient to stress.
Yeah. You know, I think that's what like a good night's sleep does to you, right? Like you wake up in the morning, you're like, you can deal with a little bit more, you know, which is good because this year's been a shit storm. So every time I sent this lamp away, about 14 days later, you know, my mood, because I'm usually just a really grumpy man. So they would come back and then I'd be like grumpy again. I'd be like, ah, what the heck? And then I shine the light on my head and then 7 days later, I'm all right again. It's like, so I started to make the connection and, you know, I have, you know, it helps me sleep too. So that's really how I use it.
That's cool. And someone asked, you know, on the heat bulb thing, cause that's kind of trending, I think, in the repeat community. And some people say like the LED light therapy devices are a ripoff. I mean, I think your Firewave's like insanely affordable for what you get, but Someone's asked, like, how do I get started? What's the most cost-effective device? Does an incandescent, like 250 watt, is that a budget-friendly option?
It's an interesting question. And unless you've really thought about it, then you won't come to the right answer. And my understanding that most guys who recommend those haven't thought about it because Matt, how hot do those bulbs get?
Really hot. It'll burn your hand.
So try and, you know, I mean, don't do this. Don't try and treat your head with one of those near infrared lights, because, you know, it's going to be really hard to get the high enough irradiance to actually do anything, because only 2-3% of the photons are actually going to pass through your skull. Like, for example, where it doesn't have hair, and enter and, you know, enter your brain. So, to get close enough to that lamp to do, for example, like transcranial photobiomodulation, like on the head, first of all, you're going to damage your skin. Second of all, you're going to catch your hair on fire.
So. Yeah. I mean, there were some times, I'm still wild, but I was like drinking wine. Like, I would have wine nights and just sitting there and just do work or whatever in the sauna and the RV. And for some reason, I was experimenting with like wine and light therapy, and they do kind of go together, but
the red wine,
right? Red wine, that UV, that stored UV light. I heard that from someone.
The bottles look really cool, like the reflections from the devices. The bottles look great.
I was going to ask something. I'm trying to. Oh, what do you think about those devices? Like, I have one that. It's like a headset. You've probably seen it with a little small lights that you put on your head and then you stick the thing up your nose, like the whole cranial nasal thing.
Yeah. Yeah. I feel like, you know, if those lights on your head were going to be effective enough to penetrate your skull, they'd burn your skull, and they'd catch your hair on fire. And, you know, so also I'm not sure like, about shining like a laser beam up my nose into my brain. Like, I'm just not sure that's a good idea. And, you know, what happens if that thing like blows up in your nose or something? I don't do it because I have these like, you know, personal like worries about that. Like, I don't like putting like anything electrical inside of my body cavities.
Maybe it's good for someone like an older man that already has barely any hair. It's already dealing with some neurological issues where it can't hurt, right? Like, we might as well. And,
you know, at the same time, it's like, you know, I understand going up the nose, right? I understand that because it's like direct entry to the brain almost. So it's like, okay, I get that. Even though I personally wouldn't do it because I have like some weird, I'm scared of that stuff. But, you know, like the EMF from some of those helmets must be pretty strong if they're going to be like attached to it, right? Like, you know, that close distance with some of those helmets. And, you know, I'm sure that, you know, that EMF isn't doing any justice.
There's all sorts of interesting devices out there. Like, I still have like the Saluma Pro, which I think is pretty fascinating, but it's really expensive. And it's more of a travel friendly that kind of scoops around your face and it has like blue light and stuff. And they have cool clinicals on that. I saw just a Kickstarter the other day. You probably saw it, the one that you could wrap around your arm. It's like a flex.
The flex beam?
Yeah.
What it is? Is that a Kickstarter product? I've seen mad guys using that thing.
Yeah. I don't know if it's over.
Like, here, any device that you can strap on your body is going to be pretty low power, because, you know, just trust me, you'd know if it was like any serious power. So I'm not a huge fan of strapping things to my body or putting them in like any areas of my body. So
about like a red light therapy enema. No, I'm just kidding.
Yeah, I mean, you know, there's actually a product like that, which I don't know the details about that, but, you know, I was pretty shocked to see it. I was like, wow, that's really interesting.
That's funny. So, someone's asking about healing ligaments with red light or infrared light. Or can red light help heal after surgery, like hip surgery or joint surgery? So I guess hip, joint, ligaments.
Yeah. So I actually think it's better at preventing, like from the literature that I read, like there was this study done on like arthritic patients with bad knees that were going to, you know, probably need a knee surgery or replacement or whatever. And it's like, it was like 7 out of 9 or 8 out of 9 of the non irradiated group needed knee replacements. Only one of the irradiated group. So I think it's really best for like preventative, you know, And you know, it's like anything else. It's like the hair growth stuff. It's like, you got to get on that stuff. Once those follicles die, you know, it's basically game over. You got to get a hair transplant. And it's the same thing with the vitiligo. It's like, if I had waited, if my mom, obviously it's like kudos to my mom for helping me with that. But it's like, the longer you let something go, the harder it is to fix.
Yep. Absolutely. Well, last question is a funny one. Any way to protect your generator and other appliances from a EMP?
What? That's hilarious. I only use EMPs for terminators, so I'm not sure about the electrical products.
If the government sends those spider bots to your house to take you out, yeah, EMP, set it off. EMP. Yeah. Revolution. I have seen a device. I wonder if it's worth it. It was like $1,000 to $2,000, and you hook it up to your main electrical, and it does protect. If there is an EMP, it would blow that out and protect everything else. I guess it's been tested. Really? I forget the name, but
that's cool. Yeah, I mean, like, I don't even know if, like, yeah, I'm hoping that never happens to me. Like, nothing's dropped like that around me. It's crazy times, though. You never know. I mean, shit.
You couldn't do red light therapy anymore.
I mean, I know. I know. I'd have a lot of mad customers. They'd be like, yeah.
Well, this was awesome, Kris. I think it was a good amount of info, and your website, EMR-Tek.com. You have a blog that's pretty awesome up there, and
Thanks,
you have articles and. Yeah, you have quite a bit of articles. And do you think you're going to release a UV light at some point? Or,
well, right now, so yeah, I mean, I have my partners have a UV light in Italy, and you know, I can set you up with them. So it's a good one. I like the mix of UVA and UVB because I like to get a little color sometimes, get to oxidize that melanin. Yeah, the reason why your skin turns brown. It's like the same reason oxygen's hitting the apple and making it brown. So that's literally how it works. But yeah, we're just wrapping up now. So that's a whole nother box.
Cool.
Yeah. I don't... we're thinking about that right now. I'm designing a lamp for, it's a guy who plays for the Chicago Blackhawks, and I made him a custom lamp, and it's huge. It's like a red and near infrared light. It's going to be called the Firehawk. So that's what we're releasing next. Really, really, really excited. He's going to track it with his Aura ring. So we're pumped for that.
That's really cool. Nice. Well, I think your products are awesome and affordable. And there's some companies out there that have just great. I mean, like your Inferno is $800, you know, right now. And some companies would sell that for like $2,000. So it's kind of insane.
Yeah. It has cob chips in it. So you get a little bit higher power. Okay. Yeah. The build quality. I mean, you have one, don't you?
I have the Firewave. I haven't tried the Inferno yet. I'll have to try. I like the design, how you have the big lights in the center of it. It's kind of cool.
Yeah. You can feel it down your back. It's a little bit extra energy on the spine. I feel like it's a good idea.
Yeah, and I didn't mention too, you have blue blocking glasses, which I think most people overlook.
They do.
Yeah. That's one of the easiest things you could do for your health, right? Just put those on when the sun goes down, especially like we had people asking about eye issues or mood issues. It's like two things, right? Block the blue and green light at night, the artificial fake light, and then get outside and see the blue sky. And this, you know, have your coffee on the porch in the morning. That's kind of the duo.
You
right?
know, yeah, absolutely. And it's with the blue blocking glasses. Like, even if like a lot of my friends who are like not super into health, they're just like my buddies. They just keep the glasses at their bedside, and it's like I'm not like telling them where these. They just know it's right. It's like, so they're looking at their phone at night. They got them on their bedside, so they're not like totally frying their brain when they're going to bed. Like it's like 10 p.m. at night, you know. And they just keep them at the side of their bed and just throw them on so they don't, you know, fry themselves.
Right. It's awesome. Yeah, and you also have an anti-radiation phone case. So you have some other cool products. Just wanted to check those out as well.
Yeah, thanks, man. With the EMF, the anti-radiation, that was like the first product that we ever made. I'm not like some of the other companies that say that, like, oh, this is like the solve all, you know, thing for phones. It's like, you know, but it's not a bad idea probably to put a little bit of electromagnetic shielding between, you know, your skin and the antennas on your phone. I don't see how that's going to be a bad idea. The problem with RF radiation is it kind of envelops things. So, you know, but yeah, that's.
Yeah, I've noticed with people, like when I'm walking into a Costco or something, or like, you know, I take a minute to pull up, you know, I don't put my phone in my pocket. I look at it, you know, airplane mode or yeah. Location services off airplane mode. That's the only way I'll put it in my pocket. And some people say even then you have to like turn off the whole phone or something, but no. I don't, you know.
It's crazy, man. I never had a cell phone until like a year and a half ago. My girlfriend's like, girlfriend at the time, she was like, you have to have a cell phone. And I was like, okay. And so I started with just it on Wi-Fi and I would run my Instagram stuff. And I've been upgraded to a full mobile data plan. Yeah.
There's stuff to mitigate. I mean, I think, you know, if you want to run your business online or, you know, use social media, just this whole, you know, smartphone thing is like, there's a lot to mitigate with it.
Dude, and it grips you too. And it's like, even me, like, you know, using, and I really never, like I said, I never really had a cell phone and I'm very aware of it. And I'm like, I know it, especially, I feel like it especially affects me because I'm just like, you know, sensitive to that stuff. And but I find myself like scrolling sometimes. I'm just like, you're going off, totally off.
I think like, people are fasting the wrong way. They're fasting from carbs or they're fasting from food. They should be fasting from social media, even for just a day, even for half a day, you know, just any amount of time. Yeah.
Honestly, I honestly believe, you know, I'm not a huge fan of the big fasting, especially not anything over like 12 hours or anything. I do think that that's really stressful for your system. And definitely the technology fasting is probably, I mean, it'd be so cool to study that or even analyze some of what happens to your body when you do that.
Yeah. I don't know. I think people make a lot of assumptions about our ancestral history and there's just a lot of assumptions made about how things used to be. And does that even matter? Because we have tons of stress today. I don't know.
Right. We're totally different, right? So it's like, it's all in context, right?
Yep.
So you got to think about everything like that. I totally agree with you.
Awesome, Kris. Well, I'll put the link to your website below, to your social media. And check out Kris's products. And thanks, man, for coming out on the show. Stick around while I close it out. That was a lot of fun.
Absolutely. Thank you so much.
Well, that's it. I hope you guys learned something about light therapy. We could really talk about it for hours. There are just so many benefits to different wavelengths of light. And I think it's useful to focus on red light, both visible and invisible, known as infrared, and ultraviolet light, because those seem to have the broadest effects. Not to say that green light or orange light or even blue light doesn't have positive effects, because they do. But I think these wavelengths can really help people in the context of what we're dealing with today, especially the red light with lipofuscin and protecting the DNA from ultraviolet radiation damage. I thought it was really interesting what Kris said about vitiligo and hair loss, that there is actually a point of no return where you need a hair transplant, or with vitiligo, you need an intense treatment instead of a natural treatment. But I get asked daily by men about hair loss and dandruff and all sorts of hair issues. And I know it's even a thing for women to be losing their hair in large amounts. And to me, this goes back to hormonal imbalance. Kris mentioned reducing DHT, which binds to the hair follicle and prevents oxygen from getting to the tissue. That's pretty much the basis of my CLF protocol, calcification, lipofuscin, and fibrosis. And there's so many causes of those three things, but the solution or the antidote is actually quite simple. And I spell that out in that blog post that I wrote about it. It sounds so simple, but if oxygen can't get to the tissue can't function, whether that's a hair follicle or whether that's a liver cell, hepatic cell, cardiac cell in your heart. Our cells need oxygen. They need to breathe. And photobiomodulation, especially using red light therapy, is one of those modalities or tools that can be used to increase mitochondrial respiration. If the cells can do that, then they can generate energy, ATP. And if they can generate energy, then you can heal, detoxify, and the cell can perform whatever function that it's supposed to in the tissue that it's located in. So check out Kris's website. It's EMR-Tek.com. And if you use the discount code Blackburn, you actually save 10% on any of their products. They have great light therapy devices. They have blue blocking glasses that are affordable and they work. I like what Kris said about giving it to a non-health conscious friend and they keep it on their nightstand. And if they're going to look at their phone right before they go to sleep, just put on those glasses. Same thing with watching the television. Just keep, if you're going to watch Netflix or YouTube or whatever, keep blue blocking glasses right next to the TV so that it's easy. They're also on Instagram under Electromagnetic Revolution. So I'll put the links below where you can check out this company and the great products that they offer. And since we're talking about light, I should mention that PUFA Protect Vitamin E mixed tocopherols is back in stock. This is an MCT oil-based vitamin E product that is very effective at protecting against lipid peroxidation. So a lot of people will just take alpha tocopherol and that's the only vitamin E they get. But the research shows that if you combine alpha and gamma tocopherol, the protective effect is even greater. And remember that vitamin E protects the PUFAs in your skin from oxidation. And what increases oxidation? Not only heat, but light, and specifically ultraviolet light. Blue light and UV light have an effect on lipofuscin, which is this glycated mess of polyunsaturated fatty acids, iron, aluminum, estrogen, but mostly just PUFAs and iron if we want to narrow it down. And that's why it's so important to block artificial light from your eyes at night or mitigate. I have the Iris Tech on my website on recommended products, and that's just a little $10 program you can download. And at night, you can put your desktop in sleep mode. And it's even great if you're watching a lecture or a video where you don't need to see the details. You just keep your computer on sleep mode and the whole screen is red. And a lot of people would say that's not a full mitigation, and it's probably not, but it's way better than nothing. And just be sure that you mitigate the light. It's so overlooked and it does really affect your hormonal system. So besides PUFA Protect being back from my brand Mitolife, I also just released two products. One is NAD Power, and that is a form of vitamin B3 called niacinamide, which is safer than niacin, flushing or non-flushing. And this is not well known. I'll be sharing a lot more information about this. But there are a lot of unsafe supplements, and I would put niacin that people get the flush in there in that category. What it really does is increase histamine, serotonin, and inflammatory prostaglandins,
which then suppresses the metabolism and causes this cascade of effects that stresses our system. Whereas nicotinamide, which is synonymous with niacinamide, in the research usually it's nicotinamide, has the opposite effect, and it actually lowers free fatty acids in the blood, which cause diabetes. Whereas niacin does the opposite. It actually floods your system with free fatty acids, shutting down glucose utilization. And again, it's not sugar that's the problem. It's the ability to use the sugar that's the problem. Things like vitamin E, aspirin, niacinamide, these things actually increase our ability to utilize glucose, which is the primary fuel of the cell, not ketones. So that's a big reason why I have this podcast, is to share this message that is really counter to what you hear in the alternative health world, which is keto, intermittent fasting, caloric restriction, starvation, fad diets, fat for fuel. It's all BS in my opinion, and it's leading people down a one-way street to heart disease, dementia, diabetes, cancer, neurodegeneration, the whole deal. So we don't want to head that direction. We want to go the opposite direction. Red light therapy, ultraviolet light therapy in context can be very beneficial and helpful to strengthen the system, lower stress, and increase resilience. As always, matt-blackburn.com. You can check out all of my recommended products. I'm always adding cool stuff on there. I've been really back on the inversion swing and hanging upside down, even for just a few minutes a day. It made a huge difference in my mobility and just how I feel throughout the day. The health of your spine really determines your overall health, so you really want to take care of that thing. And I believe that an inversion swing, especially with the spring setup, is a really great way to do that. So thanks so much for listening. Thanks for sharing this with your friends and spreading the good word about sugar and PUFAs and red light therapy and all the cool stuff that we talk about here on Mitolife Radio. Today's quote is by Alexander Wunsch from his article in the Journal of Photomedicine and Laser Surgery. Altering cellular function using low-level, non-thermal LED light is called photobiomodulation, or low-level light therapy, and is a medical treatment modality of increasing clinical importance because of the combination of high degree of penetration in skin and absorption by respiratory chain components. Light in the spectral range from 600 to 1300 nanometers is useful for promoting wound healing, tissue repair, and skin rejuvenation. In contrast to traumatic ablative and non-ablative skin rejuvenation modalities that induce secondary tissue repair by causing controlled damage to either the epidermis or the dermis, photobiomodulation is atraumatic and bypasses the initial destructive step by directly stimulating regenerative processes in the skin. Its action mechanisms encompass increased cellular proliferation, migration, and adhesion. Important cell types for skin and tissue regeneration are fibroblasts, keratinocytes, and immune cells, mast cells, neutrophils, and macrophages, which can be stimulated using specific wavelengths with significant tissue penetration properties.